Hi everyone, my name is Sam Lapiani and I'm the co-founder and CTO of Duo.com. Duo.com is a peer-to-peer internet marketplace for private small and medium businesses in short term. My co-founder Ahmed Moore, who is in this room, and I established Duo in September 2013 in Jordan. We have since finance 40 small and medium businesses in Jordan at a total value of $260,000. Today, I'm going to talk to you about some of the cool things that you can do with the Linux shell. I started working in Linux 10 years ago after having my Windows as my major development platform. After having moved to Linux, I've noticed that many of the things that were a major effort to undertake in other development environments were very simple to do in Linux. And that meant that I became a more productive developer and I also became a better developer. So I wanted to share with you some of the lessons that I've learned and some of the good things that I've learned to do in Linux while working on a Linux shell. I believe the fundamental thing that enables Linux and any Unix shell to be unique is the Unix philosophy. The Unix philosophy is a set of cultural norms. It's enforced by the developers who are in the open source Unix community. And it revolves around two central tenets. The first one is to design and develop small and capable programs that do one thing and do one thing very well. And the other thing is that the interface between these programs, what they read, their input and their output is text, is human readable text. And what this philosophy allows developers to train these small programs that do one thing or only one thing. It allows them to train them and do cool things and very easily in a way that isn't necessarily possible in other platforms. So, the way I'm going to talk about this is mostly through live coding sessions. I'm going to bring up some of the problems that I've thought of, and I'm going to attempt solving them live in front of you. I'll probably be making some mistakes and fix these mistakes as well in front of you. The point is, I want you to see the process by which a developer naturally attempts to solve the problems I'm talking about in a real-time environment. So the first thing I want to do is, I've mentioned the Unix philosophy and I've mentioned small programs that do one thing and only one thing well. I've also mentioned the text interface. And I also want to talk a little bit more about the stuff that glues those programs together, that allows you to combine them in order to do better things, in order to solve problems, in order to do pretty much unlimited things. So the building blocks, the glue that bound these programs together, the first of them is subshells, the ability to, within a shell, to fork another shell and take the results of that shell and do something else with it. So I'm going to give you an example. Let me go to bash. This is the shell. So, first example is that in bash you can have a variable. So, echo R, you have variable, one store inside the variable. You can launch a command and take the results of that command and save it in the variable as well. So, for example, you have a program called sequence, or SQDQ, which obtains a sequence of number after the number that you specify. So, C then specifies or puts all the numbers up in 10. So, if you want to save the results of that to a subshell, you just do backtick, return. And now that's saved into R. Another way of doing it, the same thing. And and you get the same results. But that's one thing. Another thing is that you can do if-then loops, put those statements like if-then statements and for loops and while loops. So you can do things like some pretty basic stuff that doesn't need much explanation. I'm saving 1.5, and then I can say if r is greater than 2, dash d is greater than, then echo. That's one of the mistakes that I told you I would be making.
Do you need a minus sign in front of the GTS?
Is that you? I think so. Let's consult the manual page. So it says integer, GT, integer, 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 2. Okay. Well, the basic structure of an if statement is so that results it exits on the if condition because that's why r equal to 1 and now I can say r equal to 4, and I want the same thing and say 4 is equal to r. It didn't work before because for some reason the r wasn't defined, but I defined it before. So that's another fundamental limit. Another fundamental limit is the ability to do loops. You can do loops over like for I in C. You remember that this is a subshell. Just taking the output of a command and looping over it. And then you get the output of that sequence. The other fundamental block is pipe. So let's say you have a command like ls error or ls, which shows you the contents of the directory. And then you can take that and pipe it to a loop if you want to. So we talk about three fundamental blocks. Subshells, control statements, meaning if that statement, for loops, and piping. And with these three fundamental elements, I want to try to solve a made up problem. Let's say you have a process which has an open file handle. Meaning it's reading from that file, it's writing to that file, or simply just has that file open. That's similar to that condition with the simple Python script. So Python is the Pardon me?
this is an infinitely learning problem that has an open file handle of a file called TechTalk. So if you look at the classes list, you can see that we have a classes with the number 17,052.
يعطيك العافية بس عفوا الصوت شوي مش واضح وشغلة ثانية إذا ممكن تتكلم باللغة العربية
اوكي هيك أحسن؟
أيوه
اوكي you can see that we have a classes that
إذا ممكن تتكلم باللغة العربية
بحاول بس أنا أسهل لي إنه أحكي هذا الموضوع بالإنجليزي في عندك كلاسز موجودة ب 17,052 هاي كلاسز فتحة فايل في تيك توك أنا آسف يعني أسهل لي الإنجليزي let's consider the case where you don't know the classes. You know a file that's open and you want to find out which classes is handling this file. So Linux, there's a very cool directory called slash clocks. And if you look at it, it has a complete description of the current state of the system as it stands right now. Including but not limited to the processes that are currently running. So before we looked at the process that holding the file open, and we find that it's 1752, and you can find a directory within slash doc that represents that process. You can see inside the directory. A lot of information about these classes, including this memory usage, amount of information, other stuff. You can also find a directory called FD, which is file descriptors. And if you look at the description here, you can see that one of the file descriptors is a symbolic link to the text of file. So, knowing this information and knowing what we just described about the fundamental building blocks of the Unix philosophy. We can build a program that allows us to find a process that has any file, an arbitrary file. So one way to do it, we take one small, well-defined program that does one thing and only one thing very well. It's giving me a lot of permission denied because I'm not rude. I don't need to be rude. I just did not the errors. So I see one error. So this process gave me the list of directories that end with FD. Actually, let me make it more specific. But you see all the directories. And then you can find the output of that. And you can pipe it to a loop. And then the other thing you can use is that you can look at, you can use a subshell to look at the contents of that directory. And see if it has the file checkbar in it. And then you can test whether there's a lot of permission denied. So the output of learning removes the extraneous information. Hmm. scroll machine again. Okay. Okay. Let me do that again. So you have classes where you pipe in the output of the classes into a loop and a subshell which makes it test whether the TechTalk file is there. And it tells you, it shows you two directories where that file exists. So it tells you that classes 17,052 has a hold of a file called TechTalk. So we've talked about loops, talked about if then statements, we've talked about subshells, and then we've also talked about we talked about piping. So all of these tools you can use with a lot of smart programs like awk, like set, like tr, like cop. They're all small programs that do one thing and only one thing well. Awk does text processing, cop does selects fields from a text, and C opens and listens to calls. So with these tools, we can do some really good stuff. One of the things that we can do is that we can implement an HTTP server in Bash in less than 30 lines. So before we do that, we just look at one of these small tools that we can use. And see, if you look at it, it's pretty much a TCP/IP Swiss Army knife. And what it allows you to do, it allows you to open a port and that's it. This right now is listening to port 5000. And if you look at it just takes out everything that it received. The server made a request, an HTTP request to that port, and you can see the output of that request in there. So how can we use that to build an HTTP server? Nice thing about NC that it allows you to interface with other scripts and allows you to do things like NC LP, which calls in port 5000. Let me clear the screen. NC 5000, and then make sure. So what this one does is that pretty much sends back to the browser whatever you send to it. So now we know how to open a port and we know how to do something with it. So how can we extend that? Let's do the following. Let's create an index.html file. Okay, and now we're going to find out a way to set this file to NC. What we can do is open another file called http.sh, and this is basically a bash script. I'm going to make a function called send, and all it does is that this is all in bash. You can do it in the command line, but I prefer to do it in an editor because it's easier to edit. Another function that sends the response. So I'm going to send the HTTP response headers first. And then I'm going to delete the file to send achieve that. Then I'm making another function called serve, which all it does is that it reads a request and then calls send response from you. So what did I do? I'm going to clip all new lines from the line. I'm going to use a subshell to echo the line in two steps, which is another small program that does one thing and one thing well, and remove all these trailing new lines. So now we have a new thing. Then I'm going to use an if statement. There is this dash d, which means test if line is empty. And if line is empty, just take out of the loop. And then I'm going to set the response. Plus x, HTTPD. Let's look at the file again very quickly. It has three functions. One, sends, just sends file, sends lines out onto the standard output along with two carriage retains. A send response function, which sends two HTTP headers, it's pretty much just a header and onto the standard output. And then read the index.html file using a loop and pipe in. I have another function called serve, which reads the request coming from the browser. Takes it in, doesn't do anything with it, just let's echo it out to the standard error. And then it sends the response that we want, which is a copy of index.html. And then we call serve. So how do we run it?
Send response.
Okay, so check the HTML file. Let's make it rendered correctly. The content type is not text there, it's text HTML. Now, correct. So now we've used, just to start again, we've used few of the fundamental building blocks that we use, the loops, the piping, the small commands that do one thing and only one thing well. And we've been able to implement a fully fledged, it's not a fully fledged, but an exaggeration. Just the simplest HTTP server. But we can do even more cool stuff. One of the things we can do is we can do some data analytics and exploration. I've downloaded the data set about the trust results from multiple trust websites out there. And we can look at the data. So it's a few websites. We have about 2.3 gigabytes of data about trust match results. If you look at it, it's just a text file. It's a text file that contains the name of the event, the site, the date, the land, who played white, who played black, and what the result was. So let's do some simple analytics. I want to look at this directory and I want to find out how many files are there. We know that ls, could give me a list of files. We can use Python and pass it to another command, small command that all it does just count lines, wcl-l, and you get 17, 12 files. Let's say I want to be more specific. I only want to concentrate on files that have a .pgn extension. How do I do that? I go to the simple utility that knows very well how to filter files. And I pass it on to the utility that knows how to count. And they both work very well together. They don't need to know, WCL doesn't need to know how LS works, LS doesn't need to know how WC works. You, as a programmer, need to know how both work. You see that there's a text interface that is readable by you, that you understand what it means by looking at it. And by combining these two together, you can get results like 1700 files in this file, in this directory. So let's take this to the next level. Let's say I want to see the number of results that are in all of these files. So as you've seen before, this is the result. And the way it's formatted is that the only important part of it is the number before the item. And if this number is zero, then black won the match. If it's one, then white won the match. If it's two, then it's a draw. And within one file, there are multiple results. There are many results. So it's not one result per file. And I want to see, now I know how many files there are, I want to see how many results there are. So what I can do is plot for result. I know that the text result exists in every one of these files. And then I'm going to count them again. WCL doesn't care what kind of output is coming into it. It just cares about the number of lines. And I can exploit that to my benefit. So now it counts. It's 2.3 gigabytes of data. Can they provide? Let's see. So you can see in the CPU usage on my computer, there's 4 CPU. It's using 2 cores so far, 2 classes. This is out. It should be done in about 50 seconds. Say again. So to tie on clutch. On a smaller data set. Let's say chest nostalgia, which is 470 megabytes. So okay, this one finished. We have about 3,300,000 results so far in all of the files. So this took a very long while. And it only used 2 cores out of a 4-core machine. So what can you do in order to make it better? So I'm going to call the command, and then I'm going to extend it to. So this command approximately took a minute. And then I'm going to do another command, find pgn. Okay, so what this command does is that it takes the name of all the files in the directory, it passes it onto something called ux-args. And the way ux-args works is that find finds a list of files, one file per line, and then ux-args slash p4 parallelizes the, splits these lines into 4 sets and runs the command get result in every set independently and in parallel. So get result here, get result here, get result here, get result here. And they all get piped into WCL. Again, WCL doesn't care how it's getting stated, it just counts. So that counts and you get the total number at the end. Let's see how long this takes. But you can see that all the CPU cores are being used to the full. You can run it in different directory as well. Calculated that number 3,200,000, same number in 33 seconds instead of about 1 minute. So we have the time. So if you notice, what happened here was a MapReduce job. It's the same thing that we deploy things like Hadoop for, and we've done this in one line of command line. This for me epitomizes the how easy does the Linux shell make very nominally very difficult things. How easy does the Linux shell make it for you? So I'm gonna take this even one step further. And instead of using grep and WCL, I'm going to introduce you to a new program, which is ARC. ARC is an event-based streaming text manipulation engine. That's ARC for it. What does it mean? So in ARC, you specify rules, and then you specify logic that will be executed based on these rules being driven. So the rules are in blue, begin, which means the beginning of a stream. And the logic here is that you should set the variable total result to 0. And then the rule here is if you see the string result in a line, then you execute this rule, then you execute this logic which increments total result. At the end of the string, you change total result for you. So we can use this instead of both grep and WCR. So, and then I'm going to ask it to run on all the PGN files, and then I'm going to find it. So
now on, let me run it on the smaller data set, which is 417 megabytes, and you get 655 and 55,000 results calculated in 3 seconds. So if I want to calculate how many times did white win, how many times did the black side win, and how many times did we get a draw, we can do it. Well,
can you explain how is it faster than parallelizing? How is awk faster?
How is that faster?
Because how is it faster than running
a because I'm working on a much smaller data set. That's first. Second is that instead of running two processes, one is counting and one is filtering, go is doing both of them within the same loop.
Right, okay.
So that's why it's much faster. So the other thing I want to do is I want to look at how many times white won, how many times black won, how many times we got a draw. So let's say white equal to zero. And then once you have result, I'm going, if you remember, the way the result looks, that there's a hyphen, and behind the hyphen is the number you get up. I'm going to split the output into an array by hyphen, and then the result, which is the result of the match, will be in array 1. It's the first number before the hyphen, which goes into result. And then if result is equal to 0, and then I can print white, black, draw. This is the awk specific. Mahmoud was asking me if this was bash syntax or awk syntax. So what's going on is that I'm launching Go and telling it to run this program. But I can do that from within the command line, which is the point. It isn't the point to focus on what exactly what bash can do, but more on to how you can glue together different items to get good results on the command line. So it's finished running. So again, we are only utilizing 2 CPU cores. Let's parallelize it. I don't need to find it now. I just need an asset and then upsides. I parallelize it at 4. So as you can see, it's turning a bunch of stuff in parallel. It's taking 2 seconds instead of 3 seconds. But it's type one line, one result per byte, and that's not what we want. We did the map part of the map reduce, and now we've got to do the reduce. So how do we do the reduce? We just pipe it again to another classes
that. I think I initialized the variable. Well, I take the first number and add it to R. I take the second number and add it to that. I take the third number and add it to the curve. End it again by blank.
You have an extra curly at the top. You have an extra curly at the top. I go up. After the gawk, there's an extra one.
Thank you. So it's utilizing our CPU cores and calculates that number. Now, this is a small data set. 470 megabytes. Let's try for the big data set quick. It's in the command line, so we can just go up. Try it again. This is 2.3 gigabytes of data. Using our CPU cores. And it took 14 seconds to do the shot to analyze the number of wins per black, number of wins per black for white, and number of wins per gloss. The interesting part is much of this analysis on data has been done, somebody did the same analysis with Hadoop on the same set of data. Actually, it was slightly smaller on Hadoop. It was 1.75 gigabytes instead of 2.3 gigabytes. And the results. Hadoop on Amazon EMR took 26 minutes to analyze the same data set. And in Shell, it took about 12 seconds. And a previous one right now, it took 14 seconds. So, what this for me means is that a lot of what you consider big data isn't really big data. It's stuff that you can analyze and crunch using tools that are available at your disposal on your local machine. Rather than spending maybe, how much, 26 minutes cost on Amazon EMR, but it's a lot of money, and it's something that you can do on the shelf. So for me, learning about Linux allowed me to first come up with these techniques and also understand the power of the things that we have at our disposal. The very simple things that have very well-known functions, very well-known interfacing, and allowing me to put them together to do all the great stuff that we can do on the shop. So that for me finishes the presentation. I just want to say that we're hiring for you. We're looking for black people, intern, junior software developers, and senior software developers, designers, and internal smart people. You can send me an email at jobs@fledged.com and be interested or talk with me after this presentation. Thank you so much. I'll take questions now. I don't hear very well, so Mahmoud will be talking the question from me, as you say, and then I'll answer it. Any questions?
How did you open the Vim to edit a command in the TIM file without writing the actual file?
Okay, so we're talking about. This?
Yeah.
Okay, so one thing you can do on shell is that you can set OVR, which activates Vim mode on the shell, and then set editor equal to Vim, and then once you have that, you click escape, B, you go back and back to the chat. Any more questions?
What makes this language different from Python? Because it sounds like it's the same concept with data, but I'm curious with knowing more about what makes this language what it is, if that makes any sense.
Which language are you talking about? You talking about Bash? Or
Python.
About Python and
Bash.
Yeah.
Bash, okay. So the important knowledge is that Python can be one of the tools that you can use in here as well. I've just chosen to use Arc because it's a simple tool that allows you that also very fast. You can do the same stuff in Python, but it will probably be slower. It will be more complicated for you to parallelize it. It will be more complicated for you to write a job that doesn't happen to do. You can do all of this stuff in any language out there in the world. But the point is, using simple tools and well-known interfaces, you glue things together. And once you know how these tools work, you can solve a lot of problems really quickly. And so, like you've seen me solve them right now in front of you, instead of sitting down and having to come up with all, reinvent the wheel for all the different steps I have to do in order to solve the problem. All these steps are already solved and are already contained in small scripts in Linux. And that's for me what makes Linux powerful. And the fact that these small tools communicate with each other via human readable text rather than, let's say, a binary interface. Or, let's say, for example, in Windows, you have programs communicating with, or sharing code or sharing knowledge through DLL files. And a DLL file is a binary format that you can possibly use without some other tool. So you can do the same stuff in Windows. It just wouldn't be easy. You have to understand a lot about how the program works, how the internal works, before you can come up with something similar. Did I answer your question? Go ahead.
I add just one small thing. It's flexibility. هلا احنا متعودين اول ما يكون في مشكله نكتب سوفت وير نحل بس لما نتعلم شل منيح يكون في very small parts but they're very flexible and very powerful in their own فصرت اعرف مثلا once you know what grep does what set does what cut does for example بصير اي مشكله instead of thinking of oh I need to write a whole software for it can just very simple thing very quick things and you get the job done very quick.
I mean try and think of how much effort would it have taken you to crunch this data in Hadoop? You have to set up the cluster, you have to write some Java program, you have to compile the Java program, you have to debug it, and you have to do all this sort of stuff. And then it will take you 26 minutes to get the results.
أنا بس يعني أنا لاحظت إنه أنت عملت statistics بسيطة. طب نفرض إنه كان بدك تعمل more complex knowledge extraction. هل هاي الطريقة أفضل مثلاً من تستخدم بلاتفورم أكتر يعني كومبلكس أكتر؟ يعني أنا فاهم إنه اللو ليفل بيعطيك حرية أكتر بالتعامل فبيكون أسرع أو يمكن لما تيجي تعمل كاونت أو سيمبل ستاتستيكال كويجن إنه بيكون أسهل وأسرع إنك يعني تستخدم هدوب بس نفرض إنه في عندك كومبلكس نولج إكستراكشن أو كومبلكس لوجيك هاي الطريقة برضو ممكن تفيد؟
It depends on what the operation is. If you see here, I can do whatever mathematically. يعني بعض الأحيان إيش ما بدي معادلات رياضية من algorithms مختلفة مش جوا الأرك.
شو نوع الفايلز؟ يعني بس text؟ ما في بقدر مثلا استخدم نوع مختلف من الفايل مش text multi media مثلا.
يعني بس text files هذا نوع. كان مش بس text files بس الفكرة أصلا من Unix philosophy إنه the communication, we see the communication of data storage, you inter-process communication, we see like a human readable text. And the point is, in the future, that
I'm not sure.
انت سالتي انه اوكي هلا انا ما بدي انه هذا الشيء فيك تستعمليه لاي شيء بس احنا بنعرف هلا بعد ما بدات البرزنتيشن احنا بدنا نستعمل الداتا سيت حجمها 2.3 جيجا بايتس ونطلع ريزلتس 12 ثانيه ممكن لداتا سيت ثانيه هذا الشيء ما يكونش ضروري بس انا خلال خمس دقائق عملت I prototyped the program, I built the program to crunch this data. كان خمس دقائق قدرت اعرف اذا هذا الاتجاه هذا بهذه الطريقه بحل المشكله صح او غلط. واذا طلعت غلط انا خسرت خمس دقائق من وقتي وبقدر اروح على شيء معقد اكثر. بدل ما تبلش بهدوء اللي بياخذك اسابيع وانجينيرنج تيم كامل علشان تسرطك وبعدين يو جت باد ريزلتس for a certain subset of problem, not all problems. You didn't find the petabytes of data. ما تصحش انك تسوي. وبالمناسبة ما تحاولوش تشغل الـ HTTP server هذا على البرودكشن. بقى على اللابتوب. بس المقصود انه تقدر تسوي شغلات في يعني there's a certain subset of problem that you can solve using tools that you already have. And if you know how to use them, then you know what kind of problems you can use to solve. You can use them to solve that problem. Joe, pass around there. Okay.
Small question. About can you debug the code that you write here?
Yeah, we step through.
Yeah, step through.
Open source.
No.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you can tell you that as well.
Just want to ask, like I've seen you are using like native commands from Linux, but I mean sometimes like you rely on the algorithm they wrote within the grip, within the Linux indexing system. It's like you are saying Hadoop is not faster than Linux file indexing system or the whole process altogether. It's like just we can go and find the algorithm they wrote within the native command to try to grab the which one is faster, which algorithm is faster. It's like if we have the core of Linux and all these commands implemented in a different techniques, it could change the or different implementation or build, so will change the results. I do feel really happy today. It's like finding oh I can run this command, then we do have a server, we can grab data and we can show it up.
I don't think I draw a parallel to the last one. But I mentioned our implementation of higher results. This is accurate results.
Oh.
But so I'm learning ما بتعطيك احكام مطلقه انه هدوب اسرع من هذا وهذا اسرع من هذا، في عندك مشكله معينه وفي يعني في تول مناسب لهي المشكله.
نعم. For example, in Windows, they do have a different indexing system for files. And Linux, they do have a different indexing system. So it seems like we are using that index. Yeah?
No, يعني هدوب بيشتغل على لينكس كمان ما في على يعني اندكسنج سيستم مع الفايل
the native one, the native inside the OS.
يعني مش فاهم سؤالك بالضبط بالنسبة للاندكسنج سيستم
It's like
الفايل سيستم
السؤال بس عندهم
grab basic is the algorithm of grab. You could find grab, find, or somebody could find a faster command from that one. for example, or he will tell you, okay, download this apt-get or this command, and it's faster.
Think about compile parameters. And you will call the compile and compile the parameter. So think about the code of parameters. As Windows, Matalan, my figure piping from subshell. And how is shell out? I'm going to glue the shell out my bottom. And let me show you something that Windows PowerShell. The Windows PowerShell video piping, but the interface data is text, the interface data objects. Programming objects. In PowerShell, but in T-Shirt, the internal stuff. You're passing objects between functions, you're not passing text.
It's not about Windows, I'm talking about the same command. The command.
The implementation
of the command. Yes, I've been using Linux for over 10 years. I mean, just about, like, if I tell you we do have a new command, it's better than grep. And we used it in this way instead of going and using different application.
If you have the kind of better command than grep, or the top of a hacking grep, or you have set interface, and you have standard input, rather than not set command line arguments, and not set output. ساعتها كل اللي احنا سوينا بيصير اسرع بس اذا بتلاحظ احنا سوينا يعني اسرع الجوريزم اللي عملناها كانت في اوك مش في جاب واوك في امبلمنتيشن يعني هذا الشغل اللي كان جاب بيعمل فلتر انلايزر كان جوا اوك واوك اسرع بكثير من جاب في شغلات مثل بس اذا كان الجوريزم ما بتعتمد على شو
مفهوم.
باش ممكن تعمل له كومبايلر على ويندوز على سايبر وتعمل نفس الاشياء على ويندوز. بس بالمحصلة هاي الاشياء موجودة باليونكس وموجودة من فلسفة الويندوز. حتى المحاولة ويندوز يعمل شيء شبيه بالباور شيل عنده شيء غريب اللي هو انه باسيف اوبجكتس. بس عندك الباور شيل انه جست انذر بروجرامينج لانجويج. It's not a glue. Of small parts.
Uh-huh.
Okay.